We acknowledge that we are worshipping on the land of the Ngunnawal people. They made their land sacred as we have made this place sacred. This land was never ceded. It was and always will be Aboriginal land. We honour their elders, past and present, and their stewardship of land and traditions. And we commit ourselves to be people of the covenant, listening, truth-telling, and seeking justice for all. Into this place and in our various other places, we gather seeking truth.
Listening beyond words of the written knowledge of God.
We gather seeking solace. We gather seeking justice. Yet too, we gather to share the things our lives have found to be true.
We gather to heal, to show the hurts and harm our
own. We gather to forgive and be forgiven.
Grace, free each other in word and new life.
We gather to stand shoulder to shoulder. And we come with thanksgiving.
For the joy of being together in community, for the blessings of knowing that we are loved by our God, and called into fellowship with one another, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
And so we light the community candle for the opportunity to be together as a community, to honour our past, to claim our future, to be alive in our present. We light this flame. And so we join in singing our first song, Our Life Has Its Seasons. It may be familiar to some people, but not to others, so Aaron's going to play it through once before we start.
Thank you.
Well, we got there in the end, but it has some beautiful words. Welcome to everyone here in the various locations, in our individual homes, and welcome to anyone joining us for the first time. This may apply at Goodwin Monash. And if there's anyone here who's rejoining us after an absence, welcome. We come now to a time of prayer. Firstly, a prayer for living attentively, and then a prayer of who we are. So let us pray. Holy God, in the quiet of this morning, we take this moment to sit in silence, to give thanks for another day, and give thanks for all those in our lives who have brought us warmth and love. We are grateful for the companionship of hearts and minds seeking to speak the truth in love, for moments we have shared with others, for times when we have reached out across barriers of distance and fear, and for times when others have reached out to us. And we gather grateful for the gift of life itself, but mindful that respecting life means both to celebrate what life is and to insist on what it can become. Amen. And now the prayer of who we are, or you might like to call it a prayer of confession. We acknowledge that we exist in God and that God is never absent. Yet we ignore the God in us. We seek our own way. We fail to see God in others. We nourish our prejudices. We perpetuate the barriers that divide us. We limit our generosity. We fail to see the possibilities open to us. And our image of God is scaled to a less than human size that we can manage. The good news is that God enables us to give the Spirit generous expression in our lives. We are set free to be joyful, loving, aware people. Thanks be to God. We'll come now to time of passing the peace. Depending what's comfortable with you, you may move around or with distancing or stay in your seats. The peace of God always be with you.
And also with you.
As usual, once we start walking around, it takes a little while, doesn't it? Okay. Now, we'll sing again, but this time to a tune we all know, okay? But we've got new words to an old tune. Richard Brooksfort Colligan, whom some people from St James will remember, was Chris Lockley loved having some of his psalms. This is his words to an old tune, God of my breathing and God of my heart.
Oh,
May we open ourselves to the seeds of wisdom that lies dormant in these readings. The first reading is from Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 to 10. The call of Jeremiah. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I am only a youth." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a youth,' for to all to whom I send you, you shall go, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, "Behold, I've put words in your mouth. See, I have set you this day over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." The second reading is from Psalms 71, verses 1 to 6. "Forsake me not when my strength is spent. In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock of refuge, to which I may continually come. You have given the command to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Rescue me, O my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel man. For you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have leaned from before my birth. You are he who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you." The third reading is from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 18 to 29. Before I begin, I have to say I found this reading quite a tough one. It took me quite a few reads to get the gist of it, so hopefully I'll do it some justice. So as I say, Hebrews chapter 12, verses 18 to 29, "A kingdom that cannot be shaken. For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them. For they could not endure the order that was given, 'If even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned.' Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, 'I tremble with fear.' But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse him who is speaking, For if they did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, much less will we escape if we reject him who warns from heaven. At that time, his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, "Yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens." This phrase, "yet once more," indicates the removal of things that are shaken, that is, things that have been made, in order that the things that cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus, let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire.
You will have noticed that today we had no sung psalm. But we will still be looking at one psalm and at another reading from the Hebrew Scriptures just to explore their wisdom for today. And there is a connection with the Hebrews reading. It is a tough one, I agree. And the Book of Psalms is a rather loosely organised anthology with various themes that keep recurring. And what I really appreciate about them is the open expression of emotions, fear, anger, anxiety, joy, whatever. Scholars have categorised the Psalms, identifying groups such as hymns of praise, royal psalms, psalms of thanksgiving, and even wisdom psalms. But the most numerous group is that of individual complaint. And Psalm 71, of which we had the first few verses, is one of those. Often they're cries for vengeance, but also to be rescued. And yet, even when, for example, the psalmist is feeling beset by enemies and is calling on God to wreak vengeance, there is a final verse or more that praises God and thanks God for his mercy. This structure is actually not really surprising, according to Hermann Gunkel, the founder of form criticism, because these psalms aren't really spontaneous prayers of individuals, but reflect fixed forms of poetry that have been transmitted from generation to generation. And these forms can be found in religious poetry all through the Near East. Let's take a closer look at Psalm 71. The opening line, "In you, O Lord, I take my refuge." And again in verse 3, "Be to me a rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me." Does this remind you of anything? A particular familiar hymn tune? To me, it brings up Martin Luther's one on Festeburg, which in the translation in TIS, a modern translation, is "A mighty fortress is our God." But I think most of us were more familiar with Mary Honor Thwaites' version that was in their hymn book, "A Mighty Stronghold is Our God." Well, I went back and looked at what I have in the Presbyterian hymn book, and there I found an early 19th century translation by Thomas Carlyle, "A safe stronghold our God is still." And I like that element of bringing in safety and of refuge, and our God is still, that sense of continuity of God's presence. I don't know whether you remember getting Sunday school verses on a little bit of paper about that size, about the size of a postage stamp. I think the one that kept recurring in my memory and in my receipt getting them was the one that says, "God is my refuge." While it is comforting to have refuge and to be held in the everlasting arms of God, and which are the words from Deuteronomy 33, I think we need to think about this not just as individuals, but in a communal context. And also recognise that refuge can be a place to gather strength, or to regroup, or to chart a different pathway. We can be an energised congregation, ready to go out to form new relationships with our community and with connections with other organisations, and open to new possibilities. There's another line in Psalm 71 that warrants attention. Upon you I have leaned since my birth. It was you who took me from my mother's womb. And there's a similar thought in Jeremiah 1, where we had the voice of the Lord saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And that's all very poetic language designed to tell a particular story. But these verses are a powerful reminder that God has been with us from our very beginnings, that we are loved by God and is a constant sacred presence. I have to admit, I don't always have this conscious appreciation of God's presence around me. It's easy when I'm out in the garden, walking along a deserted beach, up in the hills, or even experiencing something creative like art, music, dance. But when, for example, I'm having to cope with somebody who thinks totally differently from me, it's much harder. I think it just makes it very clear that to stay connected to that sacred presence and embody love in the world, it's our spiritual practices, both individual and communal, that are important to sustain and empower us. Turning to that aspect in the reading from Jeremiah about his call and commission, there's a number of interesting aspects. You will have noticed that the word of the Lord simply came to him. There was no storm, vision, cataclysmic event. Perhaps this reminds you of other instances in the scriptures. Jeremiah protests his unsuitability, but the Lord encourages his chosen one and said he would give him the words. He was to proclaim divine judgment upon Judah. But his commission included more than plucking up and pulling down. He was also to build and to plant. He looked to a new era of reconstruction. And at the very end of the book of Jeremiah, there's a reference to the new covenant, written on minds and hearts. This is in contrast to the list of requirements under the Deuteronomic law. And this reference to the new covenant is the connection to that deep reading from passage from Hebrews, which was in the lectionary. That's the connection, the new covenant. There Jesus is portrayed as the mediator of the new covenant. And you will recall that in the earlier chapters of Hebrews, there's a lot of references to Jesus being the new high priest and trying to draw a distinction between Jewish practices and what we have now in this way of following Jesus. And the final step, last few paragraphs in that reading, the recipients of that letter were being urged to grab hold of this new covenant, accept the grace of God, and see the new way of thinking, believing, and doing. The words spoken to Jeremiah of the right words for the right time reminds us of the passage in Luke's Gospel where Jesus promises his disciples that he will give them words when they testify in the forthcoming time of persecution. As I see it, we too are called to be a prophetic voice, and rooted and grounded in God, we will be given the words. But we need to be brave, be prepared to take risks, or be experimental. Our version of the brief that was given to Jeremiah would be to create, or at least work towards, a better, more caring and more just world. The basis of union refers to the uniting church as being a pilgrim people on the way to the promised end. What might this journey look like? In a recent article in the Synod Online Insights magazine by the Reverend Hee-Won Chang from Hope Uniting Church at Maroubra, she wrote on identity and the basis of union. She argued that in being pilgrim people, the church is called to live in between spaces. She cautions about idealising any of these images of living in between, or being a pilgrim people, or walking towards the promised end. And I'd like to quote a few lines from that article. If you ask any migrant, they will tell you of the pains of journeying in a new land, often loaded with frustration, anger, deep sadness, and confusion. We are not called to be a meandering or wandering people. Our final goal is set, and we know where we are heading. An end that brings new life, a new beginning, a new heaven and earth. According to the basis, the Uniting Church affirms that it belongs to the people of God on the way to the promised end. Did you note that careful direction of the wording? The church belongs to the people. The people don't belong to the church. And maybe we should travel lightly so that we may move easily without being burdened by possessions. We are to follow the one crucified and risen, and our destination is towards an end where the kingdom of God will reign. She then goes on to say a bit later, for a non-white migrant like me, to live in between is to shuffle along the margins, away from the centre. Moving away from the ways of the world, hierarchy, patriarchy, racism, ageism, violence, colonisation, things that divide and take hold of us. When we leave the centre, we have a better perspective and offer a different view. A different way of living. In this marginal space, we can offer a different language from what is proclaimed in the centre of the world. Our call is not to be at the centre, but at the end, at the margins. To be a foretaste of that coming reconciliation and renewal for the whole of creation, and to point to Jesus, the beginning of a new creation, of a new humanity. As a church, we are called, in the words of Para 3, the basis of union, to serve that end, always on the way towards a promised goal, become part of the kingdom to come. So she sees our path as to become the church perched on the margins, and while we are doing this, using these words directly from Para 4, the basis of union, in his strange way, Christ constitutes, rules, and renews us as his church. So let us inhabit that in-between space and value the journey we undertake towards the promised end.
Let's join together in singing hymn 686, Lord Jesus, we belong to you.
Thank you.
I forgot to read the first sentence for you, so I'll do it now. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. Our offerings for the celebration of life in this place and beyond may be placed in the bowl at the back of the church. We acknowledge those who give through electronic means and those who give of their time, energy, and practical contribution to the work of this church and the wider community. And so we give thanks. We will sing an offering prayer now that acknowledges the gifts we have from God and our place to love and serve. It's together in song 774. For the life that you have given.
This prayer that I found from Sandy Boyce of the Uniting Church of Australia. And this one seemed a bit fitting with displacement and homelessness rife in our community and in the world right now. And I just invite you to, when I say the words, give them hope, if you would respond with, call us anew to work for their good. Call us anew to work for their good. This prayer also uses some images of suitcases of all kinds, so I invite you also to close your eyes and picture a suitcase, perhaps a different suitcase for each situation. So let us pray. We pray for those in Ukraine fleeing to places of safety with suitcases packed with the ordinary things of life so that they may simply live. Their lives suddenly coming down to one small suitcase, dragged through the snow and rain and bitter cold. Give them hope. Call us anew to work for their good. We are reminded of people who have had to flee violence and war in many places, Syria, Afghanistan, Iran, who left with their suitcases of dreams for freedom and for a better life. And we pray especially for those in immigration detention here in Australia and for those still in PNG and Nauru. Give them hope. Call us anew to work for their good. We pray for those whose travel plans were disrupted these last 2.5 years and whose suitcases have gathered dust. And we are also mindful of those people who were not able to travel to be with loved ones in their final days and weeks, and those who were separated from family members, those whose lives have been traumatized by loss and grief. Give them hope. Call us anew to work for their good. We pray for those with courage to leave domestic violence situations who silently and carefully pack their bags to leave, seeking safety and peace of mind. Give them hope. Call us anew to work for their good. We pray for those displaced by natural disasters of flood, fire, famine, and those who have no time to pack their bags. We pray for those affected by the devastating floods in Queensland and New South Wales, where suitcases were sodden or washed away, along with everything else in family homes and businesses. And we pray for those affected by the climate emergency who have already been displaced from their homes in low-lying areas of the Pacific. Give them hope. Call us anew to work for their good. We pray for those whose suitcase of dreams has been battered, and for those discarded along the way. Give them hope. Call us anew to work for their good. We pray for our own baggage that weighs us down. May we once again know that we are not isolated beings, but connected in mystery and miracle to the universe, to the divine, to community, to each other. Give us hope and call us anew to work for good. Help us to know your work, and know your love. Ever-present God, you are with us in our hour of need. Bring hope, bring healing. Stir our compassion and imagination as we in turn seek our best loving response. Amen. Now, if you'll join me and we say together the Abba prayer. Holy being, whom we call by many different names, blessed are you, blessed are we in you. May we create with you a realm of mercy, peace, and justice. May love be done in here and now, as it is in the infinite. May we share life in bread and hope. For our failures to love, we need forgiveness. May we find the paths of reconciliation in the midst of evil's every incarnation, from the powers that possess our spirits and our structures. May we find liberation. In the power that is love, we seek to live and move and have our being. May it be so, now and forever.
God we worship is never confined to one holy place. So go and travel with the God who is found in ordinary and surprising places. We go from our gathering this morning, facing and serving the world with confidence, generosity, and integrity. Given the recent discussion around the Uluru Statement from the Heart and enshrining a First Nations voice in the Constitution, I thought it appropriate to close, have as our blessing song, the revised version of The Great South Land of the Holy Spirit. I'm sure you'll remember from the 1990s when the original version was a very colonialist words, this is our nation, this is our land. But Jeff Bullock, after he had broken with Hillsong and he had a conversation with, how he refers to his Koori brothers, he realised how ignorant and racist it was. And Auntie Reverend Denise Champion and her sister and some other helpers created a new first verse. And this has all been grafted on with Jeff Bullock's permission to his original lyrics, but it's now saying, this is your nation, this is your land, and I hope you all remember it from the 1990s and can sing it with gusto.